Shabbat Shalom, everybody, and thank you for coming to our Shabbat service this morning. And we give the glory to the Almighty God for giving us the opportunity to see today in the land of the living, and also for the government for giving us the chance to come and gather so that we can see each other's faces and rejoice before the Holy One, the God of our fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And also, the parasha of this morning is known as Parasha Beshalach. The parasha of this morning is known as Parasha Beshalach. As you can see, Beshalach means and to let go. When Pharaoh allowed the people to leave, to let go. See, that is what Beshalach means. And God, the Almighty, the God of our fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, is telling us this morning we should let go those loads that were, all those burdens that we carry upon our mind, all those heavy loads that we put in upon our head, the load of slavery, we should let it go. The slave mentality, we should reject it and take it aside and throw it out into the garbage, because the slave mentality is not for us. So this, I subtitle this morning a parasha as slave mentality and why freedom cannot exist in the vacuum. Freedom cannot exist or in a vacuum. Only the slave, the mentality of a slave, thinks that that freedom can exist in a vacuum. But freedom, when I talk about freedom, I mean the true freedom, not the false freedom that the enemy is trying to preach to the people, trying to tell them, trying to ban them in the name of freedom. He's trying to deceive people, you know, using bondage and camouflaging bondage with freedom. He said, the enemy said, "Oh, don't worry. Everything is good." You see, everything that shines, the enemy tell the people, everything that shines is gold. But it's not everything that shines that is gold. He said, everything that shines is gold. It's fantastic. You see, your freedom is yours. You can do whatever you want to do. There is no consequence. You need to understand that freedom, a true freedom, has responsibility. There is a responsibility for a true freedom. But the enemy is telling them, freedom, freedom, freedom. But the responsibility, he removed it and put it in his pocket. Because once he tells the people you have responsibility, then the people say, oh, this is no longer a freedom. Because it lies to them that freedom is 100%, it's absolute freedom. A man can sleep with a man, it's your freedom, it's your choice. A woman can sleep with a woman, it's perfect, there's no problem. A child can become, a male child can become a female child, it's fantastic. You know, and we can see even the new president that just came in not even 2 or 3 days ago signed a law that gays can serve in the military. Everything is good. It's fantastic. We are all human beings. We are all a creation of God. We are all loved by God. You see, God is love. God is love. Yes, God is love. But there is responsibility. If we have to talk about total freedom, which technically, in the Torah, there is nothing like absolute freedom. Because God said, I will give you a freedom, you have the freedom of choice to choose. But there's nothing like absolute freedom. We have to understand that. The only freedom that God has given to us is the freedom of choice. And he tells us, I presented before you 2 things, life and death. But I want you to choose life, for life is good. The enemy preached freedom, but freedom without responsibility. And we are going to see what that takes here. Israel, in the beginning, they want freedom, but freedom with no responsibility. It's a human nature. But we need to understand that true freedom has responsibility. And that is the work of Moshe Rabbeinu, to teach them that, yes, you are free, God will give you freedom, but there is a responsibility in this freedom. It's like a man who wants to have a wife, but he doesn't want any responsibility. Oh, I love you, this is my wife. Right? Now, the woman get pregnant and the man, run away. Oh, no. I don't want to take the responsibility of a pregnant woman. I don't want to take the responsibility of a child. I don't want to face a responsibility of raising up a child. Oh, I don't want to work. I want to sit down on social assistance. You have a wife, you have a child, you have to raise them. It is your responsibility. No. I don't want that. I want to enjoy my wife. Want to enjoy your wife? That's a responsibility. That woman, you have to maintain her, right? You have to buy a present. You have to take her to restaurants. You have to buy her gold, a chain, diamond ring. I mean, good things of life. Let her see the true love, not just blah, 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 blah. Right? That is it. But no one wants responsibility. Everybody wants freedom, but freedom without responsibility. And Moshe is showing us this morning that it's a responsibility in this freedom. But slave mentality is that I'm going to stick with my master. You know, my master tell me to go do this, I go do it. My master said go do this, so I go do it. And at the end of the time, my master pay me my money for my salary or my food. He gave me food to eat and give me a shelter to sleep. To me, it is enough. But God said that is not the way you are created. You are bigger than this. You can achieve more. You can achieve more greater things than this thing. This is not your calling. This is not your calling. You are not a slave. You should remove the slave mentality. So we are going to see that this morning what Moshe Rabbeinu is telling us. Parasha Beshalach. In this week of parasha, we are introduced to the food known as man, and also to the well of Miriam, from which Bnei Israel drank throughout their journey in the desert. Shemot chapter 17, verse 6. Later in the Torah, we read that Bnei Israel sang a song of thanksgiving for the well. Bamidbar chapter 21, verse 17 to 20. In contrast, the Torah does not mention any thanksgiving for the man. Why? You see, the Torah talks about Bnei Israel, the children of Israel, giving thanks when they got the water. The Torah explained perfectly well, go into details, right? You know, understand that the Torah is a what? It's a shorthand. You know a shorthand? A shorthand meaning a summary. A summary of everything that took place. But when the Torah goes into details, to write, it means that those things are very important. God wants us to understand the purpose, the reason why this is taking place. So, Bnei Israel, they did what? They were so happy, glorified Adonai, the God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, giving them water to drink in the wilderness, in the desert. But when the man come, which is called, known as the manna, in Hebrew it's called man, that's manna. When the manna fell, they didn't give thanks. Why? What is the difference? Why are they not giving thanks? Rabbi Nachman, state of New York, Brooklyn, he states, I had a wondrous answer to this question. He explained, we read in a parasha, chapter 16, verse 35, Bnei Yisrael ate the man for 40 years until their arrival at the border of the land of Canaan. The man fell every single weekday for almost 40 years. It fell even on the day Bnei Yisrael made the golden calf, as we read in Nehemiah chapter 9 from verse 18 to 20. Even though they made themselves a molten calf and said, this is your God who brought you out of Egypt, did you not withhold your manna from their mouth? As a result, Bnei Yisrael took the manna for granted, and it did not occur to them to give thanks for it. In contrast, the well disappeared when Miriam died. So, Bamidbar chapter 20 verse 2 states, there was no water for the assembly. Bnei Yisrael understood what it meant to be thirsty. So they gave thanks to Adonai when they had the water. You see? Most of us, we take things for granted. There is a saying that said that what you take for granted will become important when that something left or go. You say, oh, why did I take it for granted. Oh, you have not, you know, I've not been serious about it. Or I've not taken it and take hold of it very tight. Most of us in our life, we take life for granted. Most of us, we go, we don't even think in our head, right? How we breathe. It is when we remember, when we come to the conscious, oh, I can see that I'm breathing. But most of us, we don't even know. We just walk, we do our things, you know, everything's happy. We don't even know how we even see. We don't even know how speech comes. You just talk automatically, right? Just speak, and that is it. How the throat, you know, how it contrasts, expands, how the vibration and so on and so forth comes out to sound, to make the sound of a sound, and that you can hear and understand, and the language comes in. We don't even think about that. How the food in your belly digests and all the nutrients goes into your body. We don't think about that. We only think about that when we're sick. So, it is very important to be healthy, to be strong, to live a good life. So this is what I am. Most of all, we take things for granted. Likewise, the children of Israel, our people, we take things for granted. We only remember, we only begin to be serious when that thing is taken away from us. A woman become only remember when he lost a good man. A good man always remember when he lost that good wife. When he go and married the second wife, he said, "Oh my God, this is a devil. I should have stayed with that first wife, but it's too late. Oh, this is a devil. I should have stayed with my first husband. Oh, it's too late, my friend." This is what God is saying. Right? We lose things when it's too late. We don't give thanks. We don't rejoice. We don't glorify God for what he's doing, for what he has done, and for what he's going to do in our life, right? We'll think, it's my father. Don't worry, he's going to give me another one. Whenever I ask him anything, he gives it. Don't worry, it's my father. We take him for granted. And we can see here that Bnei Israel did exactly the same thing. They took the God of their father, they took our God, they took the God of Abraham for granted. And when they lost Miriam, they now saw the importance of water in the wilderness, because when Miriam was alive, the water was there constantly. They drink, they don't care, just like here in Canada, right? In Canada, Canada is the number one country in the world that wastes water. Number one. And we have a lot of them. We have all the fresh water in the world, it's here, it's based. Right? Canada has the largest fresh water in the world. So we can use it anyhow, but go and ask the people that live in Sudan. Go and ask the people that live in Saudi Arabia. Go and ask the people that live in Israel. Go and ask the people that live in Jordan. If you take a water and you waste it, you go to jail. That is it. But we here, we don't care. We can stay like my daughter Jade. I have to kick her out of the shower every day. You can't do that in Saudi Arabia. You take shower like this, 2 minutes, 2 seconds, you come out. That is it, it's done. But people will stay here for all day. If you don't kick them out, the children won't leave. So this is what I'm saying. We take things for granted. But God is saying we should not do that. We should not take things for granted. As they took the manna, the children of Israel took the manna for granted. The Torah in Parashat Beshalach relates one of the greatest, if not the greatest, visible miracle to occur on earth. The splitting of the Sea of Reed for the children of Israel on the seventh day of Pesach, 24th of Nisan, 2448. And the consequence, drowning of the pursuing Egyptian army in it. The event signaled the end of foreign domination and slavery under the Egyptians and beginning the freedom for the people of Israel. The catalyst for this miraculous event was the great faith of one man in the Lord, the God of Israel. This man was the prince of the tribe of Yehuda, Nashon, son of Aminadab. This is what I'm saying here, that a slave does not think. A slave is a what? It's a zombie. You know a zombie? A zombie said, go left, you go left. Go right, you go right. Stop,
he stop. Go backward, he go backward. Go forward, he go forward. He only obey commands. He's a robot, he's a zombie. That is a slave. That is a slave mentality. And Moshe Rabbeinu was trying to tell the people, you are no longer a slave, because they are still depending upon the food that they eat in Israel. And God is, and Moshe Rabbeinu, our teacher, is saying, do not fear. Freedom is scary sometimes. To break through in life is scary. You think by you being stagnant, that is where you are safe. You think being in the house of your master, that is where you are safe. You have the shelter, you have your salary, and that is it. But God is saying you are more than that. You can grow more than that. You are free man, you are free woman, you are free people. You can be your own master. Why do you want to stay under another person for the rest of your life? You can be the master of your own life. The Egyptians were coming this way. The sea is here. And the Israelites were in the middle. They got stagnant. Most of us are stagnant due to our past experience. We are stagnant in our past life. We don't want to move forward. People, even though some people tend to even move backward. Some people, as the children of Israel said, let us go back to Egypt. We are tired of this 2 second freedom. Because this 2 second freedom is very scary. The Egyptians are coming, they are going to kill us. Let us go back willingly to Egypt to serve them, to praise them, to work for them for the rest of our life. Because the sea is here. If we jump, we are committing a suicide. Who's going to save us? We are stagnant in our path, in our life. But God is saying, you shouldn't be stagnant. The choice is yours, you can make. There's always a choice. There's always a way out. That you cannot say all the roads are blocked. It is the enemy that is telling you all the doors are closed. It's a lie. All the doors are not closed. God always opens the door. God always opens the gate for his children. But the problem is, we, the children of God, are scary to make that next move, to make that next leap, to leap into freedom. It's scary. The children of Israel were stagnant. They want to go back to their life, to their former way of life, to their former experiences, because they are accustomed to that. That is, to them, it is good, it's comfortable. Because you need to understand that the flesh doesn't want to do anything that discomforts it. That is the flesh. The flesh doesn't want anything new. He wants things to be done the way it is done constantly. But the soul wants something new every time. He wants to move ahead and do something better. That is what God is saying. We should not be stagnant. I know you have your past experience, but that is the past. Is it positive or negative? You can move ahead. You can move ahead. You can make that step of faith. Just like Nashon, the son of Abinadab, made that step of faith and he jumped into the sea, and the sea did what? And the sea divided. It was him that went, it was after he jumped into the sea that the sea divided, and all the children of Israel were brought to pass through it. I want to say something here, written by Rabbi Berel Wing. It says that the final chapter of the liberation of the people of Israel from Egypt bondage and slavery. After a century of servitude, the children of Israel are finally free from the Egyptian taskmaster and embark on their journey of building a civilization. Yet, the Torah goes to great length to point out to us that freedom as a concept cannot exist in a vacuum. The people must have food to eat and water to drink. Though the Israelites will live for 40 years in an unnatural environment, in the desert of Sinai, they do not escape the constant necessity of human life. The Lord will provide this necessity through miracles, bread from heaven and water from the flint rock. These miracles, perhaps like all other miracles, will require human participation, the gathering of the heavenly bread that falls to the earth, and the striking of the rock to force it to give forth the waters. What the rabbi is saying here is this, He said that after these 210 years of slavery, it is time for them to move ahead. It is time for them to move forward. It is time for them to break the bondage of servitude. Are you not tired? Are we not tired of being under the reign of ourselves? God wants to deliver you from yourself. The greatest deliverance is for God to deliver you from yourself. How? Most of us find it hard to make a step. We begin to doubt. What is outside there? I can't move in there. I can't do this. I can't do that. Who tell you you cannot? You can do it. You have to just focus your attention and put your mind in it. Whatsoever you want to do that is for good, you can achieve anything under the sun. There is no limit for man, as God has given no limit. We can achieve anything under the sun only if we put our mind into it. But when we begin to doubt and begin to think, it's not possible, it is not possible, then it will become impossible because you have already doubted that it is impossible. But when you say in your heart, this is possible, I can achieve this, I can make this, you are going to see. Miraculously, it's going to happen. But you have to make the first step. You have to make the step of faith. You have to make the first leap and say, God, I need you. You have to come close to Him. For God said, do not be afraid, O Israel. Do not be afraid. For this Egyptian that you see, you shall see them no more. This day, I will fight for you and you will hold your peace. So it is God that fights for us. It is not us that fights for ourselves. We cannot fight for ourselves. We can't defend ourselves. But God is one that defends us, spiritually and physically. It is God that is defending His people. It is God that lifts His people up in His mighty hand. It is God that covers His people upon His mighty wings. So it is God that protects us. It is God that guides us. So once we have that faith, when we make that step of faith and say, God, I want to be yours. I want you to use me for the best. I want you to use me for the good of humankind. He will see He's going to do it. So, it is okay. So now, it can be asked that if Lord is performing a miracle for the people of Israel anyway, then why aren't the miracle complete? Why are they always somehow dependent upon human actions as well? The answer to that question lies in the question itself. The adage that God helps those who help themselves is a basic tenet and value in Judaism. Miracles provide opportunity, but these, like all opportunities, may be initiated by humans for them to be beneficial and effective. Right? Many people say miracle, miracle, miracle. You want God's miracle? You have to act. You want God to do something great in your life? You have to act. If you don't act, you are wasting your time. Like they say that heaven helps those that help themselves. If you don't help yourself, heaven will not help you. I need a job. Oh God Almighty, I need a job. I'm looking for a job. You sit down in your house, you fold your hand. You sit down there. You will stay there for 200 years and you will have no job. You ask God, God, I need a job. What do you do next? You go outside. You search for job. You go on the internet, search for job. As you are searching, God will give you a job. God, I need money. God, I want you to bless me. You fold your hand. You don't do no work. You sit down in your house. You need a food. You have to go to the magazine. You need a food. You have to go to the store. The food won't fall down from heaven. No. Even though the manna that fell from heaven, human still has to do some work. The Torah said, okay, this manna you shall go outside and gather it. Okay, do you think that God cannot make the manna to fall in their room? Of course, God can do it and make the manna to fall in your room. Not even in your room, to fall in your pot. Right? On your table. But God said, no, it doesn't work that way. Human beings we have our own part to play. In every miracle under the sun that ever comes, that is always a what? Always human part. We have to do our own part. Without our own part, that miracle will never happen. So the people of Israel went out and they gathered the manna, they bring it in and they eat. You want a baby? There is no Virgin Mary here. You want a baby? You get a baby. You have your husband, you have your wife. You bought meat, you have a baby. There is nobody Mary anywhere. So people trying to tell us some story that does not, that never even happened. Miracles. For miracles to happen, man has to play his own part. For you to be blessed, you have to play your own part. For you to prosper, you have to play your own part. Because it is the combination of you and God working together to perfect the world, to perfect the creation. That is the purpose of man. Our purpose under the sun is to work together with our Creator, to work together with our God, because we are not a zombie. We work together with Him to perfect the creation. It is difficult for the Israelite people over the 40 years sojourn in the desert of Sinai to appreciate their newfound freedom. People become accustomed to almost anything in this includes slavery and servitude. An independent person create their own society, provide their own needs, and continue justly in a contentious world to retain that freedom. A people accustomed to slavery will find this to be particularly challenging. Slavery induced in their mind and spirit a false sense of regularity that broadened upon security. The President of the United States once remarked that if you want to be certain of having 3 meals, then one should volunteer to spend the rest of their life in prison. He will receive this throughout his incarceration. A free people has a lot of things to think about. A free people has a lot of things, has a lot of actions to do. They have to think about the security, protection, provision, all kinds of things. But a slave does not need to think about that. That is why you see the MD of a company, the general director of a company, the chairman of a company, they earn millions of dollars while the workers earn nothing. Because all the work, all the things that has to be done to make that money is going on in the mind of the MD. That is why the MD earns a lot of money while the workers that actually do the work earns nothing. So a slave doesn't want to do anything, just want to sit down and let the master tell him what to do. So freedom sometimes is scary, but we have to liberate our mind. With this slavery mentality, we have to remove it out of our mind. We have to tell ourselves that I am truly free. We can give a step of faith and move forward and achieve the greatest achievement of our life. Moshe Rabbeinu continued to encourage the people, because these people, they have this freedom, this slavery mentality, and that is why they did not see the promised land. Because with such a mentality, you cannot enter into the promised land. The mentality is so awkward. That's why God allowed the next generation, their children, who has no freedom, who has no slavery mentality, to inherit the land. But those people were all wiped out because of their mentality, the slave mentality. We can win if we depend upon God. You can win if you depend upon God. You can rise up and say, God, I want you today. God, I want you to use me. God, I want to be that person as you use Moshe Rabbeinu. I want to be that person for you to be used. To do what? To propagate your word in this world. And God will use you. Don't be lazy. Don't think it is impossible. Before the people will be looking at me of my past will deny me. No. If only you desire. If only you desire, you want it, and that will be done. Whatever you desire shall be given. Moshe Rabbeinu, our teacher, encourages us. He's telling us, stop having this slavery mentality. Because these people are down. Their mentality is, God said, I can remove you out of Egypt, but I cannot remove Egypt out of you. You have to remove that Egypt out of your life. God will not do that for you. God can deliver you physically and other things, but your mentality, you have to change it yourself. God will change that for you. You have to rise up. We have to rise up. We have to say, yes, it is time. Time for total freedom. Not partial freedom. Total freedom. From physical slavery and spiritual slavery. So people are free physically, but spiritually they are still in bondage in their mind. Once your mind is free, you are free indeed. Once your mind is free, you are free indeed. You can say, I'm free physically, but you are still enslaved in your mind. God is asking us this morning or this afternoon to free our mind. Be free. Don't hide it. Don't take hold to that past life. It's past. You can make a step of faith and leap into freedom, a total freedom. Parashat Beshelah. Shabbat Shalom.